Good afternoon, guys. I'm making this video about the recent High Court judgment, Supreme Court judgment. It is very controversial. Judgment in a writ petition, which sounds like it is the judgment of a contempt petition against Mathew S. Nedumpara. This is a 33-page judgment, and I have it right here in front of me, and I'm going to show you what it's all about, and let us look at it. This is a writ petition filed by National Lawyers Campaign for Judicial Transparency and Reforms and others versus Union of India and others. Now, obviously, it means that Union of India has to defend this petition. It has to be defended by Attorney General of India. But this petition was dismissed in the very first hearing, and it was dismissed not because National Lawyers Campaign for Judicial Transparency and Reforms had anything wrong with them. Their conduct was not criticized, their conduct was not part of the picture, but Mathew Nedumpara, advocate Mathew Nedumpara, who represented the petitioner, was, according to this judgment, a horrible person, a very bad guy, who has misconducted himself in various judicial forums across India. And from the way this judgment is structured, it would appear that this present writ petition was disposed of, was dismissed summarily, because of the sheer odious nature of Mr. Nedumpara. That is how this judgment looks at it. And it is quite shocking that without issuing process, without giving him show cause notice, without initiating contempt proceedings, why did this judgment in writ petition number 191 of 2019, Mr. Nedumpara is convicted of contempt. He is not accused, he is convicted of contempt. So a man who entered this proceeding, the advocate Nedumpara, when he entered this proceeding, I think he had no idea that he was entering a proceeding that was anything other than a normal writ petition hearing. When he exited, he was a flustered man because the hearing didn't go well at all. But I don't think he imagined that he stood convicted of contempt. 6 days later, when the order was uploaded, he realizes to his shock that the order has basically damned him. Now let us look at the paragraph that dismisses the writ petition on the strength of its let's look at what is what it says about the writ petition itself. You know, what is the merit of the writ petition? Because the very first paragraph is straight away about Nedumpara. It says, in the course of arguments in the present writ petition, Shri Mathews Nedumpara, learned counsel appearing on behalf of the petitioners, alleged that the judges of the court are wholly unfit to designate persons as senior advocates, as they only designate judges' relatives as senior advocates. Okay. So, this is how it starts out, about his allegation. And then it says, on being asked whether such a designation should be granted as a matter of bounty, Shri Nedumpara took the name of Shri Fali Nariman. When cautioned by the name, he took Shri Fali Nariman's again. Now, I'll come to the significance of Shri Fali Nariman's name. Okay. But I'm just pointing out that in the first paragraph, instead of talking about what the writ petition is about, what is the matter being set out before the court for its consideration, this judgment dives straight into the conduct of Mr. Nedumpara. And thereafter, it does not return to the topic of the writ petition until the 15th paragraph. And then it says, in the 15th paragraph, that is on the second last page of this judgment, insofar as the writ petition is concerned, the writ petition in essence seeks a second review of our judgment reported in Indira Jai Singh versus Supreme Court of India through Secretary General and others, 2017 9 SCC 766. Even otherwise, it is settled law that an Article 32 petition does not lie against judgment of this court. We are also of the view that Section 16(2) of Advocates Act 1961 is a provision which cannot be said to be unconstitutional, and the designation of senior advocate cannot be as a matter of bounty or as a matter of right. Now, for these reasons, the writ petition stands dismissed. Now, it would have been more apt to say that for this singular reason, okay, which is set out in, I say, 3-4 sentences in this paragraph, the writ petition stands dismissed. Okay. So what is the writ petition about? Nedumpara seeks through the writ petition, or rather the petitioner, which is National Lawyers Campaign for Judicial Transparency and Reforms. It is not only Nedumpara. It was represented by Nedumpara, but it is not only Nedumpara. There are a large number of lawyers across the country who are members of the National Lawyers Campaign. This petitioner sought that rather than handpick the lawyers who are then, shall we say, anointed with the title of senior counsel, rather than handpicking them, there has to be a more objective criterion, and the criterion suggested was simply experience at the bar. So if a person has 30 years or 35 years of experience at the bar, then the judiciary may just designate him as a senior. It's a very egalitarian approach. And the argument is that currently only people who are handpicked by the judges because of their connections, because they are judges, the children of judges or the children of senior counsels, or the relatives, close relatives of senior counsels, or coming from a very famous law firm, or connected to ministers, connected to dignitaries. These are the kind of people who get chosen as senior counsels. So this essentially is an aristocracy, not a meritocracy, an aristocracy which has been created over the years, over the decades. I'm using my own words. This is not what the petitioners have used. They have not used the word aristocracy. But I, as a common man, am speaking my mind on this and saying that this is more or less what is being said. And it is an oligarchy that has been created wherein the people who are designated, the lawyers who are designated as senior counsels, enjoy enormous disproportionate power and enormous disproportionate ability to earn wealth on a day-by-day basis. So if a normal ordinary lawyer can charge 5,000, 10,000 per appearance, someone who's been designated as a senior counsel can charge anything ranging from 70, 80,000, 1 lakh rupees at the lower end of the spectrum to 15 lakhs, 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs at the higher end of the spectrum per appearance, per hearing. So in as little as 15 minutes, he makes that kind of indecent amounts of money. So this is an oligarchy, and therefore it should not, and it deprives the ordinary litigant of the services of the senior counsels. So very clearly, what one would argue, and I argue from a common man's perspective, the writ petition of the National Lawyers Campaign it represents a very worthy cause. It is a cause that may not, that the judges may not love, because the judges are part of this hallowed set, this oligarchy. But while the judges may not want this, while the judges may not love this, the fact of the matter is that it goes to the heart of problems, many of the problems that are faced by judiciary as a whole. And the common man is suffering as a consequence of judiciary's inability or unwillingness to address these problems. Now, this is the cause, and that cause was summarily dismissed in three sentences. Now, let me tell you what is creepy about this writ petition, the judgment. This judgment is, to use a word, creepy. It is creepy. What is creepy about this? What is creepy about this is that, first of all, it was being heard by a bench who are related to some people who would be affected very badly. Rohinton Fali Nariman and Vinit Saran. This was the bench. Now, Rohinton Fali Nariman reacted very badly to the mention of his father's name, Fali Nariman. Fali Nariman is the doyen, absolute. He is a guru. He is a Mahaguru. And he appears as counsel in the same court as his son, the Supreme Court. Now, let us be very clear. He appears in the same court as the son, as his son, who is a judge. I mean, where his son is the judge. Even assuming that he does not, and I believe he does not appear before his son, but think of the enormous clout that this gives Fali Nariman when he appears before a brother judge of Rohinton Nariman. I'm sure his son's colleagues, brother judges, would want to call Mr. Fali Nariman uncle. Okay. Rishte mein wo tumhare uncle lagte hain. Yeah, wo tumhare baap lagte hain actually. Wo tumhare guru lagte hain. So it already gives overwhelming power. But when he is Fali Nariman's father, because he is Fali Nariman's father, it also brings that kind of rishtedari into the mix. So Mr. Fali Nariman would naturally have the tendency to get orders for the asking. Whichever client can afford to engage Mr. Fali Nariman, and I'm sure Fali Nariman's fees would also be they would be astronomical. Whoever can afford Mr. Fali Nariman is very, very likely, he is overwhelmingly likely to get the orders that he wants. And that is a fact of life. He may even get the judgment that he wants. He would be heard very seriously. He would be heard with disproportionate seriousness. Now, let's go back to the judgment. The judgment says that Shri Nedumpara took the name of Fali Nariman. Now, I am going to assume for a moment, I am going to reason out why this is such a creepy judgment. Okay, what is it that creeps me out as a member of the public? I am going to assume that the events that happened are exactly the way they are mentioned in this judgment. That is, I am going to assume that Mr. Rowington Nariman and his brother Judge Saran were 100% right on the facts. Okay? I am going to assume that whatever they have said about Mr. Nedumpara is 100% correct. Even then, this order looks like a completely creepy order, and here is why. Okay, so he begins in the very first paragraph that Shri Nedumpara, excuse me for a moment. Bro, keep your voice low, please. He alleges that Shri Nedumpara took the name of Shri Fali Nariman, and when cautioned, he took Shri Fali Nariman's name again. Now, what is this take the name? He mentioned Fali Nariman. Is it a crime to mention Fali Nariman's name? In whatever context he mentioned it, let's not get into that because clearly he doesn't want to. Rowington Nariman doesn't seem to want to talk about it. But is Fali Nariman the new F word? Is a question I would like to ask the Honorable Supreme Court. Is it an F word? Why is it wrong? Why is it contempt to take the name of Fali Nariman before his son Rowington Nariman? What is wrong? Question one. Okay. So he says that Nedumpara promptly denied having taken Fali Nariman's name. So, and he attempted to justify the same but failed to offer any adequate explanation. So, let us assume for a moment that he named him. He called him by name. Was it wrong? Is that contempt? It would appear from the common man's perspective that Mr. Rowington Nariman is, you know, speaking in the, as we say in Desi Bhasha, तू मेरे बाप पे जा रहा है, मेरे बाप पे क्यों गया बे, you know, this is the kind of this thing about he mentioned his name, वो मेरे बाप पे गया, which is ridiculous. It's a ridiculous thing for a Supreme Court judge to say, even if it is 100% true. It is a ridiculous basis for this judgment. Second, now he says, we are of the view that the only reason for taking the learned senior advocate's name without there being any relevance to his name in the present case is to browbeat the court and embarrass one of us, which is embarrass Mr. Rowington Nariman, obviously. Now, they are of the view, yes. Now, if they are of the view, that view does not become a certainty. It remains a view, it remains an opinion. So Mr. Rowington Nariman may have an opinion, and let us assume that the opinion is correct. Let us assume for a moment that Mr. Nedumpara indeed intended to browbeat the court and embarrass Mr. Rowington Nariman. Let's assume that. Does it mean that the court can jump the gun and without any due process, it can immediately condemn him, convict him of contempt of court? Can it do that? So it says, Shri Nedumpara then proceeded to make various statements unrelated to the matter of hand. It's an opinion. He stated, your lordships have enormous powers of contempt and Tihar jail is not far. Okay, so he may have said that. He further submitted that lawyers are like judges and are immune from contempt as they are protected by law. He also stated that there can be no defamation against a lawyer, as also there can be no contempt proceedings against a lawyer, as the same would impinge on the independence of lawyers, which they ought to enjoy to the fullest. Let us assume that he said all this exactly in this way. And then the judgment goes on to say, all these statements directly affect the administration of justice and his contempt in the face of the court. I would like to ask the Honorable Supreme Court, making a statement like this in court, how did it affect the administration of justice? Is the administration of justice not able to function after this argument? Are the judges so ruffled that they are no longer able to be judge-like? What exactly did he do that affected the administration of justice? And let us still assume it is contempt in the face of the court. Let us assume that is indeed so. If that is so, then issue show cause notice. How did you condemn him? How did you, without giving him a hearing, how did you just go from this opinion to a conviction? That is a question. And then, now this gets creepy. Now this is where it gets creepy. These first two paragraphs have disclosed the issue at hand. And then the rest of the paragraphs, about 10, 11 paragraphs or 12 paragraphs, go on and on about what Mathew Nedumpara has done on various other judicial forums and in various other cases. So it says, this is not the first time that this particular advocate has attempted to browbeat and insult judges of this court. So now, this honorable bench is making common cause with other benches who have had grievances with Nedumpara in the past. In point of fact, the style of this advocate is to go on arguing, quoting Latin maxims, and when he finds that the court is not with him, starts becoming abusive. That's a generalization. That's a huge generalization. Did someone have all the other judges created a report? Have they created a record of all this? We also find, it says, that this advocate is briefed to appear in hopeless cases and attempts by browbeating the court to get discretionary orders which no court is prepared to give. We have found that the vast majority of appearances by this advocate before us have been in cases which debtors have persistently defaulted, as a result of which their mortgaged properties have to be handed over to secured creditors to be sold in auction. Now, assuming that this is 100% true and Nedumpara has appeared in cases where debtors have persistently defaulted, let us ask the question. Debtors who have persistently defaulted, do they have the right to be heard, yes or no? Do they have the right to be defended by a lawyer, yes or no? There may be no merit in what they do. There may be no merit in their case. But do they have the right to be heard, yes or no? And I believe the judiciary, the Supreme Court, has all the powers to throw out their cases as lacking in merit, but they have the right as citizens to a legal representation. And does an advocate who represents such debtors render himself liable to contempt proceedings, summary contempt proceedings, where he is going to be accused and condemned in one single judgment, which may not even be contempt proceedings against him? That is ridiculous. So it goes on. It goes on in this vein. It talks about, Even the present writ petition is a case in which a review petition against the judgment of this court in Indira Jai Singh has already been dismissed. Now, this might have been relevant if all these earlier sentences weren't there. This sentence would have shown that this honorable bench was at least applying its mind to the case at hand. Fair enough. Now it goes on, okay, it goes on to cite the, it talks about another special leave petition filed in November 2018. It's a separate cause, remember. Why is a separate cause being brought? Why is the order of another SLP being mentioned as a justification for the judgment of this case? Is a party allowed to do that? Now let's go further. But even so, let us say this. If no party has placed these facts before the Honorable Court, and I believe that no party has done that, is the Honorable Court able to come to its own, come in with foreknowledge? Okay, let's look at another thing. If the aforesaid, so they're talking about a case where Mr. Mathews Nedumpara, who was advocate for the petitioner, said that 80 lakhs would be paid within a period of 4 weeks from 22nd October, but the court granted him 1 week from 22nd October. No such payment was made, and hence the SLP was dismissed. And they are saying that Nedumpara had the matter listed again, and the matter was mentioned on 14th November, and they had warned Nedumpara, who had appeared as a counsel. Now, all this may be true, but none of this is a part of the present writ petition. If these were contempt proceedings, and then Nedumpara is being tried for contempt on many counts, different counts, and they may say this is contempt, and then they may say and one more count, so this is aggravated contempt, and so on and so forth, then this could be relevant. But these are not contempt proceedings. This is a writ petition, and the judgment should concern itself with only the writ petition. Now there is one more. We also find that Shri Nedumpara has misconducted himself repeatedly before the Debt Recovery Tribunal, Bombay, and before the Bombay High Court. The amazing thing is, and it brings various other cases which happened in 2012. Criminal suo motu contempt petition of 2012 recorded this. Mr. Nedumpara has disrupted the proceedings, etc., etc. So let us ask the question. Okay, it goes on with various other cases against Nedumpara, which have not attained finality, which are in fact sub judice. There is a case where Bombay High Court issued notice to Nedumpara in 2012 or 2013. Where he is supposed to have impersonated a judge. Now the judge who issued process, the Bombay High Court judge who issued the show cause notice to Nedumpara, himself is not convinced that Nedumpara has actually done this. And after that, there has been no hearing. So, why is this sub judice matter brought up, mentioned in detail as a proof of his contempt of the Supreme Court? Did Mr. Rohington Nariman and his brother judge gather all this evidence against Nedumpara within 6 days after this hearing, where Mr. Nariman was offended by the mention of his father's name? Did they have a commission of inquiry to gather all this information? And it just gathered all this information from Debt Recovery Tribunal, from Bombay High Court. They said, give us every possible information about Nedumpara. We need to fix this guy. Is it allowable to have such a commission of inquiry against an individual without disclosing what the parameters are, what the cause of action is? Can you have this kind of a commission of inquiry about a single individual? Is it lawful? Because if it is, I would be very interested in the Supreme Court starting these commissions of inquiry against various ministers. That would be lovely. And if you can make it a secret commission of inquiry, which goes into people's actions, you know, studies their conduct before various forums, unrelated cases, brings it all together in a conglomerate, and this report suddenly emerges one day in a judgment, and that person stands condemned, he stands convicted. I would love to do this to some ministers, some very corrupt ministers. Is this possible in India? Can we do this? I believe this falls foul of so many fundamental rights. Life and liberty, for sure. Is the government allowed to snoop on Nedumpara? Or is the judiciary allowed to snoop on Nedumpara? If this is not snooping, I don't know what this is. So let me go back to now. I mean, it carries on in this vein for paragraph after paragraph. What comes across is, and I speak as a common man, and I think we as common people need to speak and need to take a view of what the Supreme Court is doing here. It appears that there is some kind of a very concerted effort being made here to fix this man. So someone somewhere seems to have said, let's fix him. Let's fix him good. And so you have this. Paragraph 13. Conduct of this kind deserves punishment which is severe. Though we could have punished Shri Nedumpara by this order itself, okay, so they could have been the judge, jury and executioner in this order itself. That's what it says. So now they are saying that we are merciful and just. So it says, in the interest of justice, we issue notice to Shri Nedumpara as to the punishment to be imposed on him for committing contempt in the face of the court. Now, so what is contempt in the face of the court? Saying all those things earlier and maybe speaking in Latin phrases and mentioning the F word, the new F word, which is Fali Nariman. That was his contempt.